I think I would really cherish the first time I was like there. I think that girl in yellow boots was also the time when I really started to feel that when I was shooting that movie that, you know, I can make it in this business.
Hey Gulshan,
how are you doing? I'm doing okay.
It's the first time we're seeing face to face actually. We spoke I think last time, but it was on a call type thing.
Yeah. Look at that. What's that poster you got at the back?
Avengers.
Oh, so Avengers.
I need this to look good, right? So I have pop culture on this side.
Oh, that's nice. Yeah. So side. I have like, I have Gustav Klimt. So
I'm art illiterate. I know films, I know books, but like painting, photography, I'm like zero.
Right. I mean, I don't know much myself, but then I do come from an art background. Mm-hmm. Like my education was in fashion, so that's sort of, you do get a little bit of introduction into fine arts because of that.
Aesthetics.
And yeah, Gustav Klimt was a Russian artist, and I really like his work. And of course, this is a print, this is not an original. Originals will be like crores of rupees. I can't really afford all this.
Yeah, I can imagine.
But and I don't want to also. I don't want to, like, I don't have that, oh, one day I'll own these paintings or something. Art is good. Art is like, exposure to art. No, but like I also feel that I'm not an artist as a painter or a sculptor or something. But if I can appreciate and let art influence my creativity, then it definitely adds to my craft. Other people's craft can definitely add to my craft, even though our crafts are very different.
Like you build on each other maybe. And film is like a biggest form of that, right? It's all collaborative.
Yeah, absolutely.
First off, congratulations, 10 years in the Hindi film industry. It's been like 10 years since your Girl in the Yellow Boots came out. And
it's been 9 years since, as in technically it's 2011 because that Girl in Yellow Boots previewed in Venice in 2010, but it didn't release. So I don't know how you would like to count it. Like if you would like to count 10 years in the business from that date, yeah, it's 10 years in the business. If you want to count 10 years in the business from the first release, that's 2011. So that's next year. If you want to count 10 years being an actor in the business, regardless of release, then it's 2008 onwards. So that way I've already like pushed. So
it's a little all over the place, but I'll take this as 10 years because I've decided.
I will accept your congratulations nonetheless. Thank you for the congratulations. I wholeheartedly accept it.
So in retrospect, how is your career right now? How do you feel about it? Or actually what I wanted to ask most importantly was, what are your most memorable movies or moments in this 10 year of experience?
I think I would really cherish the first time I was like there. I think that Girl in Yellow Boots was also the time when I really started to feel that when I was shooting that movie that, you know, I can make it in this business. Because of the environment that I was working with, the people that I was working with, the immense amount of trust that Anurag Kashyap had in his people who worked for him. So I felt really trusted. I felt that I could really do... really like, you know, sort of express myself creatively and like not really be bothered about, or they're not going to allow me to do this or something like that. So it was very liberating. So I remember really being on the set for the first time, although it was not the first film that I ever filmed for, but I would really say that for the first time, I really felt very comfortable on a set. Didn't feel intimidated. I felt very calm, composed and very, very creative. So that was definitely very special, and that memory will always probably last till the end. There are many memories. It's really difficult to sort of, you know, pick like just one or two. Like there are many such memories, but I would say that for this, because you asked, just to illustrate make a certain point, I would pick that because it gave me the confidence also. Like, you know, while shooting for that film, I really felt that, you know, I've left all of these things behind and I've come here to this new city. I'm making new friends with new people. Most of the people who I'm working with, I don't know them. But I feel very comfortable here. I feel like I belong. You know?
Kindred spirits.
So, Yeah. I felt like I belong here. I didn't feel like I didn't belong here, like in front of the camera. Like when I was not facing the camera, that's a different matter. I was uncomfortable. But when I was facing the camera, I was very comfortable doing it. And I was very happy that I was, that I wanted to do this always as a professionally. And I was getting an opportunity to do so. And it was going very well.
Actually, in the recent times, the last movie I watched of yours was Ghost Stories. Actually, I wanted to ask a couple of questions about that. Sure. Ghost Stories, right? Like I knew you were a part of the film, but I didn't see you in the trailer. I couldn't find you, but I'd seen you. I just didn't recognize you basically. So yeah. Working with that kind of prosthetics, right? What was the feeling and how did your process maybe change in any way? Because you can't really use a big part of your face, right?
Yeah. To very simply answer your question, it was the most difficult thing I ever had to do in my life. It was the most excruciatingly gruesomely painful 7 days of my life.
Okay.
Shooting with Dibakar as Riya Ke Papa in Ghost Stories.
Mm-hmm.
I think with all the other roles, you know, like there is a, you feel more free as an actor because you have more control over your senses. Like, you know, your, how you would like to project your emotion, your body and all, things like that. And when you're in prosthetics, it restricts you. Like, you know, it takes away a certain natural instincts from you. Mm-hmm. And so you have to really practice moving a certain way. And it can be very restrictive. And actually, the more time you get, the better it is because the more you get used to it.
Mm-hmm.
But that's not all the, that's not the case every time.
Okay.
So I really, I would say that I completely submitted myself to that, to the costume. And I said that you're going to now tell me how I should perform, you know, and to the director.
Okay.
And to Dibakar completely, like wholeheartedly, I trusted him with everything because it was exhausting. Like it was really exhausting. And sometimes really, I didn't know what to do. So and he would like call out some shots, like, you know, look outside the window, do this, do that. So if I know that people credit me with a performance and all that, but I can't take a lot of credit for this performance because a lot of it was Dibakar actually calling out over the mic, like do this, do that. So that was very different because I usually don't work like that. You know, you usually have your discussions, creative discussions with the directors, and you do your rehearsals and your blocking, and then you do we have our own, like I have my own inputs. If I have, I'll show them, you know, we could do probably do this, do that. So I felt really restricted, but I didn't fight it. I was like, I'm not going to fight this restriction. I'll just like go with the flow. I'll just submit myself because this costume is not going to do what I want it to do. I have to do what it will allow me to do. So that was very different.
So a little more into that thing, like, so how many days of shoot was it? And each day, right? Like how much of your time was gone in the pre-production part of it? Not pre-production in the sense, setting up the whole thing and
yeah, the getting ready part.
The actual shoot.
So about 7 days.
Mm-hmm.
We were shooting really like very interior Maharashtra and the monsoons were like still on, like pretty late into, like, I think it was September, but then it was incessantly raining at that point of time. So that was also a problem because the prosthetic suit doesn't work in the rain. So if you get rain, then the hair, it destroys the hair, a lot of the things. And yeah, so it doesn't really work. It's not designed to work in the rain. It's designed to work in dry conditions.
Okay.
So that was also like, that was difficult and it threw a spanner in the works because like we would shoot and then the moment it starts raining, there'll be umbrellas and plastics around me and then, like, you know, I'm taken away to thing. And it was like, although the weather was quite nice, but then because of the suit, I was constantly sweating also. So that I was dehydrating and so I had to figure out how to do that. So it was difficult. It used to take anywhere between like 3 to 4 hours to get ready and about an hour and a half to get it all off. So there were some days when we did manage it really quickly, like in about 2 hours and stuff like that. So as the days went on, I think because you need a team. So initially, I think there would be like, you know, 5-6 people working. But then I think towards the end, there were only 2 or 3 of them working. So that was actually more efficient. We would get ready faster. So that means like at 2:30 or something or 3 a.m. in the morning, I'm sitting in the makeup chair and I'm getting piece by piece, they're putting things on. So that was like, you have no sleep. Like it was quite physically and mentally challenging. Yeah.
Maybe cuts down on your instincts, right? Because you can't behave normally.
Yeah, you can't move normally, like your fingers don't move. I can do this, right? I can do all of this like that. All my facial muscles have control over it. When you have the prosthetics, it just doesn't move. Like doing this, like to be able to do this, I have to put literally all my strength. So if like, if I have to keep my hands on the table like that and I have to do this, because there's fake nails and all that, I'm literally like, it's like, fighting. I have like a 50 pound dumbbell that I'm like doing curls with. So I'm like, like that. So there's a close up of my hand. I'm like, jaldi na, shortcut.
That's nice.
Yeah, it was funny, funny that way. Yeah.
So another performance of yours this year, which I wanted to talk, but in the opposite way, is from Afsos. So Afsos, I saw as a very Cohen-esque kind of dark comedy, which is very mannered in performance and everything. The same way that maybe the prosthetics were controlling your performance here. Here you had to be in a very specific way and deliver your lines in a very specific way. How was that experience, maybe?
I don't know about specific way, but then I think the writing also guided me, like, you know, guided my imagination, like when I was sort of reading it and all that. Because I thought it was kind of difficult to pull it off because, like, the character of Nakul is a loser. Like, he's an absolute loser. He's not the hero. Like, you know, as an audience also, like, you know, you like to watch people who achieve things or, like, you know, who do things, who are good looking or like, and for a protagonist to be interesting, like being a loser is definitely not interesting at all. So how do you still make it interesting? So that was tricky, but I think we got the right like balance. Me along with the director and the writers, we could figure out exactly how to sort of do that. And a large part of it was also the writing really, you know, helps you with those situations. The only thing that I had to do was that, you know, sometimes actors have a tendency to play losers as very dull, as in like low on energy and all that. So I didn't do that. I didn't make that choice. So I think that worked in my favor of making the character more interesting when all those different scenarios the writers had given me when I put myself in that. So it wasn't a specific way, but it was also a discovery process. And we had some time. Like the writers and me had, they kept coming to me from a very early stage when it was just a concept. Some concept notes to, like, you know, first do like a detailed synopsis to the first series of drafts. So I had seen a lot of this initially only. And then once Anubhuti Kashyap came on as a director, we had like, you know, readings and discussions and rehearsals with the scene. So a lot of these ideas that I had, some of the ideas that they had, we could really sort of put that in place and figure out what works and what doesn't work.
So what I wanted to ask you about was from Afsos, the idea with the OTT penetration, right? Especially because of the whole lockdown and Corona thing, Amazon, Netflix, Z5, everything's become a household name. Everybody's watching everything online, and even the producers don't know exactly if the open the theaters, is it feasible anymore? So what I wanted to ask you is, how is it for the technicians, actors, and people in the film industry? And are the opportunities a lot more easier, or are people listening to you, people more like?
I think it's definitely more work from the volume point of view. Like, you know, there's a lot more work for people to do. So see, before the app based like OTTs came, it was cinema. I mean, you could work in cinema, you could work in television, and you could work in advertising through like TV commercials, right? And then if you had any experience working on stage, then you can do some theater. But like, nobody really makes a serious living doing just theater. It's usually like when you're in Mumbai, it's a combination of all of those things. So a lot of my friends, people from my friend circle, that's exactly what they would do. They would like, some of them would do television serials, and then they would do like shows of plays. And like, you know, whenever they could, got an opportunity, they would do a film role. And then TV commercials too, were like all the time. But this, when the series format started to come, I think it created more opportunities for actors. So you have another one more, you have more options. So that way, in terms of like, you know, revenue, like for the people working in the entertainment business, it's definitely an opportunity to make more revenue. It's like you can like make more money because you have more opportunities. So, so that is one positive. But I think initially people didn't really realize that what it's going to be, how it's going to be received, like, you know, what would be its audience. Audience base, like how much would be its penetration and things like that. And over the years, people realized that it was sort of growing, it was making its own audience, and also a certain section of the audience. Our audience is very diverse. A certain section of the audience who like to watch something different or content that was not really mainstream content kind of gravitated towards the OTT platforms because they said like the stories that we want to watch, like, you know, like because of our exposure to like, you know, international cinema and other HBO series, etc. We like content which is made, which is also rooted in our culture. That is kind of similar to that. So that opportunity was created. But of course, like the OTT platforms were growing, and then there was a fear, and I would also admit that I was also one person who was a bit skeptical that cinema will probably find it hard to coexist with OTT platforms, because once the business model starts to work and everybody will just say like, we don't care like about cinema anymore or having cinema theaters anymore, we'll just shift everything to OTT because this business model is great and everybody is like really making a lot of money. I mean, you'd be surprised that how many people are actually in the business of making money than business of making cinema. Okay, I'll just leave it at that. You'd be very surprised. A lot of the flag bearers of cinema are interested more in
capitalist and incentive based, right? So
yeah, so it's like that. I mean, there is an imbalance there. Anyway, that's a separate topic. But it so happened that I think cinema and OTT platforms started to coexist, which also started to affect views of people like mine, saying that, oh, yeah, okay, fine. Like, you know, it will, because this is also cinema. Like, you're just experiencing it through a smaller screen, right? I mean, ideally, in my opinion, in an idealistic world, you should be able to experience the cinematic experience is sitting in a large dark room with like, you know, 500, 600 strangers and experiencing something, having private experiences while you're sitting among strangers. But that's not possible. But it still creates enough opportunity for people to tell their stories. And also it gives them a lot more freedom in terms of how they want to say it. For example, with longer formats, you have much more freedom to explore more plot lines and more characters. And we have seen examples of this through a lot of very famous HBO series, that American series, etc. They explored this, like be it The Wire or the Game of Thrones or Breaking Bad. You have a lot of interesting characters and you have like a lot of subplots also you get time to explore. Whereas cinema is very restricted to maybe 2.5 to maybe tops 3 hours. Like more than that, it can't really hold your attention. It becomes very difficult. So the number of characters that you can focus on also is limited to maybe say 3. Or four, not more than that.
Or even the world you want to build is going to be a lot.
Yeah, world you want to build. Yeah, but that is beautiful. The beauty of cinema is that the restriction, within that restriction, that you get to tell stories, which we really, I mean, still I think cinema is the paramount. Right? It's the top of the heap. Like it's the absolute, like it's the world champion. There's nothing really that you can say that compares to the cinematic experience or box office glory. Like, you know, the whole experience of being a movie star. Proper movie stars are one who will get people into the cinemas, right? They are still proper movie stars. It may change, but I do see it like sort of trying to coexist right now. The COVID situation is very unfortunate, but also it kind of revealed the whole possibility. I mean, it did make a lot of people very insecure because there were no answers. Because you didn't know. This is not like the monsoons, na? No, I do start around this time, but around give or take, you know, 5-10 days plus or minus, yahan tak khatam ho jayegi monsoon. And this is a regular phenomenon through like, you know, hundreds of years. So, but this is not like that. You don't know what's going to happen and whether people will have the will to come and all that. And it affected a lot of businesses. And people were sitting on finished products. They didn't know what to do. So everybody moved. You know, there was a big gold rush. They all moved to OTT platforms. And OTT platforms are like, okay, we're going to buy. But now, I mean, this usually happens. Like, and when there is a trend initially that's working, everybody will want to rush over there. And then it starts to balance itself out. Oh, this is working, this is not working. And the cinemas will open again. I think there will be a very nice ecosystem where both cinema and OTT will coexist. Like in the 80s and 90s, like particularly in the 90s when television had its boom. In the 90s and like a bigger boom in the 2000s, it didn't really kind of topple cinema. Right? It had its own viewership and it sort of like it did crossover also, because the viewers, the cinema goers would watch television viewers would watch, like people who watch predominantly TV serials would also sometimes go to the cinema and watch. So that was that. So I think that kind of an ecosystem will be created eventually, and once things really nicely settled, So, but of course, like, and which is good in a way that, again, I'm very old school that way, because for me, cinema, I'm a cinema purist, but I'm also trying to sort of, have take a softer stance and say that not everybody's films can release in theaters, because it's very the business model is very difficult. It's ruthless.
The threshold's a lot higher.
The format is great. The format of cinema is great. The cinematic experience is fantastic. There's no, as I said, there's nothing comparable to it. It's the Paramount. But the business model of box office is ruthless. It puts so much pressure on people. So what OTTs do is that you can create cinema with which does not cater to that business model, but it's still cinema. The way you experience it is different, but it's still a very good experience. And it's empowering also. It's empowering to smaller producers, smaller new directors, and people who want to sort of, try something new at times. I'm not saying that it's entirely possible for you to do whatever you want. No, it's not true. But then it's still, it has far fewer restrictions in compared to cinema, not from a storytelling point of view, purely business point of view, like the business model point.
That makes sense, because you have to pay a lot more to go there and you have to hold them for so long. And the amount of money you spend.
See the return, how it money is invested. See, now let's take art out of this completely. Okay, the craft of filmmaking or storytelling, we'll take it out. We'll focus on the business. How does the business model for theatrical releases work on box office returns? Right? There are certain percentages. Like from every week, the percentage is different. Producer ka itna milega, the distributor will get this much, exhibitor will get this much. This is share, profit sharing. There are certain numbers. I'm not very well versed with that, but there are. As the weeks progress, those numbers are also changed. So the longer the film runs, the more money the producer makes. So the pressure is always on the first three bloody days. Friday, Saturday, Sunday.
Yeah,
that's like, yeah, so that's pretty much it. And sometimes as you see, like, films that are not very good, sometimes are hyped up so much precisely because, like, if you do very good on the first 3 days, you're out of the water. You hold steady more or less for the so
front load, like, the market. Smaller
films, yeah, and for smaller films it's also difficult because you're also competing for attention. Now what happens is that, say for example, there's a smaller film, like, I have a film out, and then Akshay Kumar has a film out. Right now, he has such a wonderful track record with the exhibitors that they'll give him more shows. Right? It makes perfect business sense. Right?
Yeah.
Because he's for like 20 years he's been earning them money. Why would they give Gulshan Devaiya's film like 6 shows at prime time slots, like at 8 o'clock or 9 o'clock or 9:30 on like a weekend? They won't give that to my movie. They'll give it to his movie because he's guaranteed that he's going to make them money. So you understand the rigidity of the business model, how difficult it is. So which means to get at people's attention, to get bums on seats is that much more difficult. So that is slightly evened out. I mean, it's a lot better when you look at a digital space. So purely from how it's empowering to, from a storytelling point of view, from a craft point of view, and it sort of levels the playing ground. If you look at a Patal Lok, it was enormously successful. Scam 1992, enormously successful without really any marquee names.
Yeah.
Right? And they are marquee names now in that particular format. Like, they were star makers. So it evens the sort of platform. But being able to achieve that in a theatrical is extremely difficult. Not because of any politics or anything like that. That's a different matter again. Just the business model is so difficult and rigid to sort of crack.
Makes sense. You just need such a big head start for it to make work.
Yeah. Yeah. Then of course, like, craft, creativity, politics, power politics, that these add more complications to it.
Actually, one of the things I wanted to ask about was, in the other sense of OTTs, a big news that came out last month was that OTTs are coming under the purview of MIB. There'll be actual restrictions placed by the
MIB, MIB.
I wrote it down as notes for me, so it'll be easier.
MIB, my God.
Ministry of Information.
Men in Black. wouldn't mind it. Let the entities come under Men in Black.
Men in Black would be great.
They keep wiping out everybody's memories whenever we did a bad show. They wipe out memories, they don't remember only.
They won't have a problem with censorship also then, right? You could just make them forget. So in that sense, do you think that is going to cut into any kind of creativity with the artists, or do you think it would
be very difficult to call right now? It's too early to sort of call. Okay. there is a film certification board, which is the CBFC, right? Mm-hmm. In order to make certification for, say, the OTT platforms, because it's considered as private viewing, OTT perform, unlike television, it's private viewing, because you can have your own password and all those things like that. Now, regulation, what kind of regulation it is going to be, I'm not really sure. Until and unless they pass actual laws, only then you'll understand. And it's not only OTTs, it's also targeted at a lot of media outlets. And as you might have noticed yesterday, Huffington Post had to shut down.
Yeah.
So this is the result of, like, you know, you have, like, you know, there are lots of, I mean, it possibly is political also. I'm not really sure. I'm sure there is a political angle to it also. The cracking of the whip and things like that.
Yeah.
But unless and until there is an actual bill passed in the Constitution and there's amendment made to the Cinematograph Act, if I understand things correctly, don't take my word for the bottom line, but I'm also a little kacha on this one because I'm also, like, you know, learning up on this.
Huh.
But I think they have to make amendments to the Cinematograph Act for, like, proper censorship, for a censor board, for either the CBFC to, for this to come under the umbrella of the CBFC or to create another board altogether. As of now, it just says that all of these things will be under the Information and Broadcasting Ministry. It does not mean that they will start regulating, but it means that you're answerable to them.
Mm-hmm.
Right? So they can, like, they have access to you. Now, what this will eventually mean, I don't know. Of course, the, like, you know, cinema and such things are soft power. Sometimes certain political entities would want the soft power to work on their side. I don't know. I don't know what this is going to be. So we'll have to wait and watch. It may not necessarily be that, oh my God, like, we can't, like, you know, have censorship. We can't, like, swear or, you know, show kind of nudity or anything like that. People will assume a lot of things. But unless and until we see how the government will react to things, specific cases, whether they will have directives, like television, like, you know, television, most of television is self-censored. Right. So they don't have a censor board giving every TV serial and every episode a certificate. But a lot of television channels, they censor on their own. And this had already started with OTT platforms. Okay. A lot of the shows, they themselves decide that this is the line. We're not going to cross this line. Right. So that is going to continue to happen. Perhaps it will, a lot more people be a lot more cautious as to how they want their content to put out. But to assume that this is going to destroy the OTT platforms is a little premature as of now. I know there is a certain distrust of the government. There is a certain distrust. I generally have I don't trust politicians and blanket ruling as a given thumb rule. I find it very difficult. But anyway, this is... So considering all of that and the political atmosphere, one would assume that, you know, that this is going to be, like, bad news. I'm not so sure. I think we'll have to wait and watch for it. It may not be. It may not be. Like in the case of, like, you know, when this whole thing about banning pornography and all that come, there was a huge thing. I don't think. I think specifically certain websites were targeted by the ministry, but then not all of them. And their reasons were perhaps, I don't know what their reasons are there to sort of shut down certain, maybe safety, national security reasons, or maybe some other reasons. To block, you know, child pornography and things like that. But it's not banned as such for private viewing.
And
it's not a crime to watch porn. In this country, it's not a crime to watch porn. Yeah. So similarly, like, so it's not regulated. So I'm saying that that's not regulated. Viewing is not regulated, right? So I'm just saying, going by that example, it may not be that the OTT platforms also will be, the viewing will be regulated.
You were talking about how new actors, when they're coming into the industry, right? It's more important for them to understand how to position themselves and try to figure out how your marketing works and how to place yourself in the market. Your craft and something that comes out of your passion, but there are things that you don't learn when you're getting into the industry. This has become, like, a huge thing over the last 1 year, right? Because of certain unfortunate events, which led to talk about nepotism and, like, a bunch of things in the industry. Do you see actual changes that have happened over this conversation, or have people's perceptions towards them just changed?
I don't know, because the industry is not fully open. So I've not really interacted and seen, like, unless and until there are red carpet functions and award ceremonies and film premieres and all those things where you get to see who's hustling what and how. you can't really assess. No, I don't think so. I don't think there has been any change. And the change has been more from my side, like, my perception and my understanding. And I'm trying to implement this. And I'm not particularly keeping an eye on other people also because it's I'm not really got that opportunity. The important thing for me is that the craft and career are two different things. And some people are like so focused at their career and they give it everything. They do everything that is possible to sort of have the career, the kind of career that they desire, right? They all they say that like, I want to have this kind of a career. And then they go all out to get it. And some do get it also, but and some don't get it. But it can be extremely exhausting. Like if you don't have do's and don'ts, and if you're ready to do whatever, at some point you will also realize that you did all the things that you didn't wanted to do also because you wanted that career. And now you don't have that career. But you still had to do, like, you know, many people like 10 saal maine industry mein struggle kiya, I did this, I did that, but still I'm nowhere. You have that, you have that disappointment and that which creates disdain for other people also, and you blame others for your misfortunes. So all these things will happen. So that's burdening. I don't want to have that. Like, you know, I don't know what kind of a career I'll have. You know, I may have my dreams and ambitions, but 10, 15 years down the line, I don't want to be in a position where I'm bitter that nothing really happened to me. It was that person's fault because they, like, you know, vetoed my casting or they didn't give me opportunities or these people didn't give me awards or those reviewers didn't, like, you know, write me or I wasn't invited to, like, you know, this thing, that thing and all stuff. I don't want to have that kind of poison running in my veins.
Yeah.
This is my perspective. I share it because I think it's useful for people to have a conscious understanding of what exactly the hustle is. Because it's a game of perceptions. We are nobody's better or worse than the other. It's all a perception. So that's the hustle. You know, in order to, you know, get somebody to cast you, have a good opinion about you and all that. That's the hustle. What are you prepared to do for it? To have that, to have an impact on other people's perceptions or to be able to control their perception in a positive way. What are you prepared to do? And what are you prepared not to do? These are the questions that I am asking myself. And I think people should also ask themselves so that they know beforehand that this is a game of perceptions. This is what we are in. There is no merit. Merit is a fake. It's an illusion. It cannot exist. You can't demand it because it cannot exist in the arts.
And regarding the same thing, I wanted to ask you one more thing. Is there's a huge backlash towards people who are already established at this point or what they call like the same backlash that was against Gunjan Saxena or Kali Pili. And I felt like even Gunjan Saxena, they hated on it more because of there was something else to hate on rather than look at her work as it is. So what do you feel like that? That is just like a reactionary thing, right, in a way?
Yeah, it was reactionary. And there's a lot of disdain because a lot of people come here and then there are people who know how to take advantage of that disdain. And that's exactly what happened. There are power structures. And power structures are, they do have their corruptions, their fair share of corruptions. And somebody decides to crack the whip or pretend to crack the whip or, you know, or call out that this is a righteous fight and all that. So people who have a lot of disdain who will kind of ally, will all rally up to sort of lend voice to that voice. It wasn't a righteous fight. Exactly. And a lot of people who cry foul are doing the same things that they accuse the others of. I'm telling you, by my own experience and my observation.
The operative word there is pretend, right? You could have done that even before the
con. Like, they're no less corrupt than the ones that they're accusing. It's just that, you know, we don't want you to do this. I don't want you to do this. I want to be in your position. I want to do that.
It's almost exploitative.
That's not a righteous fight. That's not a righteous fight. If you want to put an end to, like, if somebody is trying to improve the working practices, or like the hours and shifts and that will benefit people working in the industry. So then there is some that could be a righteous fight or exploitation, which was a problem. Which is right now, thanks to the Me Too movement, it's somewhat a big issue. So people are really quiet about it. But I don't know for how long that. I really hope that, you know, it doesn't go back to good old ways.
Yeah. As long as there's a establishment, right? So,
but at least we have some kind of awareness. Okay, this kind of reporting can be done or things like that can be done. But I do still hear of people, you know, nothing.
That is going to always happen, like anywhere there's power imbalance, right? People.
Yeah, man, but it's going on. Like, I'm sorry.
Yeah, it's a shitty thing, but it's just. What's
So the improvements is only like, you know, it's improved a little, but it's not completely eradicated.
So I think those two topics we're done with, all the controversial stuff is done. Let's get to your personal thing. In the sense, so there was a in your career, right, there's a bunch of literary works that you've been part of, like Ram Leela, or like most of your work is heavily dependent on the script rather than just a character or something, right? So I wanted, do you read a lot?
Not at all.
Okay, so I'm scrapping that question. So I wanted to ask you five favorite books that have influenced your work or your acting style.
I'd have a hard time thinking of. I'm definitely going to say King Solomon Mines in one of them.
So yeah. So another. So my final question would be: so what are the five movies or shows during this quarantine or something, or made during the quarantine that you've loved, you would want our people to watch?
I don't really like recommendations, man. I don't know. Okay. I think it's just, I really like the fact that you can discover something also sometimes, and particularly during the lockdown. I didn't watch a lot of the shows that everybody were really gushing about also, because I had my own, I was also reassessing my own, you know, path and my strategies and, you know, how I'm going to move forward. Precisely for the reason I told you, like, you know, I don't want to spend 20 years in this business and decide that, oh no, you know, I am in this bad situation because of somebody else. I don't want to point fingers at anybody else. I want to be okay if I fail. By failure, again, it's like, you know, maybe I'll still be working, but then, like, you know, my career would not be like, you know, a spectacular career or something. So it's a possibility. And I want to be okay with that. Agar ye hai, toh theek hai. I'll do my best. Of course, I'll give it everything that I have, that I'm willing to give, that I'll give. But then there's always a line, like, beyond that, I'm not going to. So I watched a couple of my friends had some interesting projects come up. So one was Scam 1992. So I don't need to say anything. I mean, these are shows that people have already seen. Like,
yeah, yeah, yeah.
Yeah. I'm a follower of, I've been watching The Crown. So I watched that also. And the latest season was kind of interesting. I'm not really a Star Wars guy, but I started watching The Mandalorian.
Okay.
I don't know. For some reason, it's kind of interesting to me. I mean, I'm not really thrilled by it, but it's something different, and I am kind of enjoying the episodes.
It's kind of detached from the lore anyway. So
yeah,
from
I
the
think
main
the
lore, it's kind of detached.
I find it a lot more interesting. The Mandalorian's character a lot more interesting. And I'm not a Star Wars fanboy. I know a lot of people are. I don't know for what reason, I just couldn't get into it. Like The Lord of the Rings, I'm like totally into it. But like, it's fantasy. But then this is also fantasy for some reason. I can't really get into it. The Better Call Saul, I finished the last season of Better Call Saul. That's something that I really like. And not many people watch it because it's, I think it's because it's a slow burner, but it's fabulous writing. It's one of the best, like it's so well made, the whole series, the acting, the writing, the plot lines. The background action, like it has some of the best background action I've ever seen in any series. I really enjoyed that one. And a friend of mine had a movie that came out called Raat Akeli Hai, so that I enjoyed watching that also. Hani Trehan, he's been my producer, he's a friend. And of course, Radhika was also in the film. I enjoyed that. I don't know if I have any recommendations as such. Like one of my films also released, so yeah, you should watch that. Foot Fairy is available on Ant Pictures, on television right now. It'll probably make a debut on OTT platform some other time. And like all the hype behind like Patal Lok and 19 Scam is very real. Like I really enjoyed it. And Mirzapur season 2.
It's cool, right? Like there's all these new like people that we've seen, but they're in the front of the show and they're actually doing this great work.
I liked season 2 Mirzapur more than season 1. Season 1, I was like, I mean, I watched it, then I stopped watching it, then like a week later, I'd watch it. So I took my own time finishing season 1. But season 2, I think like I had a lot more enthusiasm for the season 2. It was a lot more prolific. I don't binge watch things anymore. I don't know why. I just got over it. Like I feel like I'll watch something and I'm like, it's done for today. Just, now we'll do something else. So I don't really binge watch it. And then sometimes I'm conscious also. I save it like, if it's done, then nothing will happen for tomorrow. What will I do from this time to this time? Like, you know, instead of doing some faltugri on Twitter, I'd rather like watch this.
Also, Gulshan, what are you doing next after Foot Fairy? If you can talk about any project that is interesting.
Yeah, briefly I can. So before the lockdown started, I was in Rajasthan filming for this project tentatively titled as Fallen. We had to stop that. It's for Amazon. So we had to stop that and we were sent home. And then the lockdown began. So that's going to restart restart soon. So we are preparing, like we're getting back. Mm-hmm. Like, yeah, I've cut my hair again. So long hair has become short and the salt and pepper is back, all in preparation for pollen. So that's going to begin again. So I'm going to finish that and then move on to other things. Mm-hmm. So as of now, it's just restarting pollen and finishing. Mm-hmm. That's going to take me a few months. Easily like 2 to 3 months. And then after that, we'll see.
Great one. That was really great. Thank you so much for giving your time. And
I have shot something for Rajan DK. That's all I'll say. Like I had, I did shoot something for, and it's not Family Man.
I'll put that as my title. It's not Family Man.
Yeah, it's not Family Man. So the announcement, I think, will come from their side only. Like wherever they're ready. But that was enormously fun. That was great fun working with them. And like after so many years of like sort of coexisting in the same business, it was the first time that we worked with each other. Mm-hmm. And it was a whole lot of fun. It was a fun script. It was really fun. There was this fun prep. We had to prep for it. And during this whole COVID lockdown things and the shoot and all that. So it was kind of exciting, but I think it's come out really well. So
And
fingers crossed that people will also enjoy it. When it comes.
All their stuff always seems so fun. Like I can't imagine.
Yeah, and Squashy also. So I had so much fun.
Yeah.
I had so much fun working with them. It was really nice. And I was like, and it's just completely out of surprise. Like they approached me and it's like, oh, we have this script. Like we want to make it with you. So like, I'm like, yeah, sure. I'm sitting at home doing nothing.
You know? Cool. Thank you so much. Thank you so much, Gulshan.
Cheers, let's lovely
do this some other time again. Thank you.
Yep.
Press the bell icon so that you don't miss any updates from Workspace.